We return now to the escalating fight over a major oil pipeline in North Dakota. This weekend, more than 120 protesters were arrested, part of a months-long campaign being waged by numerous Native American tribes and nations against the Dakota Access oil pipeline. For the latest, I'm joined by our William Brangham, who reported from North Dakota last month and has been following the story closely. William, so bring us up to date, but first remind us, what is this fight all about? What are the arguments on each side?
The fight, as you mentioned, is about this pipeline. It's the Dakota Access Pipeline. It's a 1,200-mile pipeline to bring oil from North Dakota, the Bakken oil fields, down to Illinois. And the point of contention here is right at the border of the North Dakota-South Dakota state line. And that's where the Standing Rock tribe has a reservation. And their primary source of drinking water is the Missouri River. This pipeline is going to go right under the river just north of their reservation. And they say two things. One, if that pipeline leaks, it's going to contaminate their only source of drinking water. And two, the construction process will desecrate burial grounds and ancestral sites just north of their reservation. So that's their argument. They don't want the pipeline there because of that reason.
Right.
The company that's building this, Energy Transfer Partners, argues they've done all the legal permits and applications, and they've done all the bits that they're supposed to do. They also argue that this pipeline is a far safer way of transporting oil than trains or trucks, which are much more prone to crash. And there is data that backs that assertion up. They also argue that we live in a carbon-based society. We drove to work today, people are going to drive to work tomorrow. And until we figure out a different way of moving oil or find a different way to power our houses and cars, we have to deal with this material, and they argue the pipeline is the way to go.
So where does the actual construction stand right now of the pipeline?
The energy company says that the pipeline is about 60% built. So you can imagine the pipeline is moving in from the north and the south, and it's the real holdup is at this point right near the Standing Rock Reservation. And that's where most of the protests and the arrests that we've been seeing have been happening, where members of different Native tribes, primarily Standing Rock, go out to these places where the construction is still going on, and they chain themselves to the trucks, the police come and arrest them, and that's where the conflict has been happening. But the pipeline is largely done. And that's really where the fight is going on right now.
So we know there's still a couple of restrictions that have to be lifted before they can go ahead and finish with the construction. But once that happens, what do people expect will take place?
Well, that's really, that's a very dodgy question. People don't exactly know what's going to happen. If the Army Corps agrees to this last permit and says to the company, go ahead and finish, drill under the river, the question is, what will all of these protesters do? We saw thousands of people out there. It's not clear if they will voluntarily get up and leave. It's not clear if there will be a fight. Who is going to evict them? I mean, the jails out there are already so full, they have to bus people they arrest outside of the state. So will the National Guard be involved? Will this very militarized police force step in? Nobody really knows.
And William, you and I were talking earlier. You were saying how unusual it is that you have, what, over 100 different Native American tribes that have come together to make up this protest. Why over this particular issue?
That's really the most fascinating part of all this, because there have been plenty instances in the past where you could have seen tribes coalesce around an issue. I think social media had a lot to do with this. The tribe, the Standing Rock, has been very, very good at getting their message out. Every time there's an arrest, every time there's a protest, every time there's something they want to promote, it's on Facebook, it's on Twitter, it's on social media. So that's brought people together. I think also that this was not a fait accompli. It wasn't a done deal. And so when they put out the call and said, come help us, people felt like they could stand in the way of this, and they, for whatever reason, people from all over the country, really all over the world, came together and said enough is enough.
And I know you're going to continue to watch it. It's very much an active scene right now. The protest goes on. William Brangham, thank you.